Unit 3 it deals with the laser, just the fundamentals of laser. I think all of you know what is meant by laser. Any one of you say the expansion of laser? Bala Vishnu, can you say the expansion of laser? Just say whether it is right or wrong. Can say.
Sir, I can't remember. Sir, I can't remember.
Can't remember. Okay, right. Others just have a try. Umang Kumar, do you know the expansion for laser?
Sir, hello. Light amplification start out. What?
Yeah, yes, we have seen during the bridge goes also. A light amplification, that's right. What about the next three
letters? Stimulated emission of radiation.
Yeah, very good. So light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So the normal light, it can be amplified by the stimulated emission. Okay, light is amplified. You know, sound is getting amplified when we speak through a microphone. It is amplified using an amplifier. So the normal sound, so the normal sound is getting amplified. So likewise, this laser is the light is getting amplified and you will get a high intensity beam, light beam. Okay, so that is a specialty that is happened because of the stimulation. Stimulation means some triggering you are giving by some external sources. So there is some process out there how to give that stimulation. So stimulated by, because of the stimulation, it will emit the radiation which is having high intensity. So that is why it is called as light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation, right? Okay, so this is what given. What is laser? Light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation, as you said. So here, what will happen means the light will be emitted during the transition of atom or molecules in different energy levels. When it is moving from a higher energy level to lower energy level, it start to emit the photons. So it is like a chain process, and finally we will get a high intensity beam. So here you see, this is the difference between the normal incandescent light and the laser light, or you can say the ordinary light and the laser light. When you look at the wavelength of light emitted by a normal bulb or the incandescent light, so you have many wavelengths. Many wavelengths, and it is multi-directional. Will travel in multi-directional, then it is incoherent. And in laser, it is just opposite to that. It is monochromatic. So monochromatic means it has a particular wavelength, single wavelength. Then it is highly directional. I think you have played with the normal small laser. I hear some sound. Please mute yourself, students. So highly directional, so it won't have a large divergence like the torch light. Okay, you can see the torch light when you focus the light onto a wall. It will diverge and you will get a big circle on the wall. When you focus the laser light onto a wall, you will get a small spot. Here the angle of divergence is very small, so that's why it is said to be highly directional. Okay, it is monochromatic and it is highly directional and coherent. What is the coherent? Coherent means, you know, this laser, the output of laser, it consists of waves. Okay, when you look at these waves, the waves, or if you take two waves, okay, if they have the same amplitude, then same frequency, same wavelength, but same path, phase difference. Okay, phase difference means, you know, it is a sinusoidal waveform. If you consider one wave, others are same, only there is a phase difference will be there, maybe a pi by 2. Instead of starting from 0, another wave starting from pi by 2. The same phase difference will follow throughout this wave. Okay, if it is like this, then it is said to be coherent waves. So this laser consists of the coherent waves. Laser emit coherent waves. So these are the characteristics of laser. One is highly monochromatic, and second one is highly directional, then highly coherent in nature, and one more is there, that is, it has a high intensity beam. So what is meant by intensity? The amount of light which is falling onto the material within a 1 square meter area, or one unit area, you can say 1 square millimeter or 1 square centimeter or 1 square meter, whatever it is. So within that particular, you just consider 1 square centimeter. Within that, so here we are discussing about laser, so you can consider 1 square millimeter, that is opt, I think. So within that 1 square millimeter, how much amount of light is falling? Then you compare with the ordinary light. So that's intensity. So laser has very high intensity. So these are the characteristics of laser. One is highly monochromatic, highly directional, is highly coherent in nature, and it has a high intensity. Okay. So monochromatic means single wavelength. Directional means it has low angle of divergence. Coherent means if you have two waves, it has same wavelength, frequency, phase difference, etc. And the last one is it has high intensity. So these are the four characteristics. This is a very important 2-mark question. Okay, so here one by one they are explaining. So here you see the high coherence, how it is coherent in nature. This is just a normal light. It is incoherent in nature. If you place the wave one over the other, it won't have the same. It won't be same. Here you see, if you place this wave over the other, okay, so neglecting this phase difference, this is about the highly coherent property of this laser. Now let us see the basic concepts of laser. That means, what are the processes involved for the production of laser? So just I am saying what is what, we will see in detail in the next class, because we have a derivation, that is Einstein AB coefficient, there we will see in detail. So just let me say what are the processes involved. So first process is absorption. So you can say it is stimulated absorption. Why it is stimulated absorption means you are stimulating an atom or a molecule from a lower energy level you are going to move it to the higher energy state by providing some energy. So this energy is in the form of a photon. Okay. So we can provide energy in different forms. So first, for the basic reason, in order to understand this basic concept, let us discuss with the help of this photon. So when you pass this photon, that is nothing but light. The light is passed. So just consider only one photon. This photon is absorbed by the atom in the lower energy state. Okay, so that is the first process, absorption, or you can say it is stimulated absorption. So that is the first case. It is absorbing and moving to the higher energy state. Right? Then Second one is spontaneous emission. So in the first case, what happened means not only one atom, millions of atoms will move towards a higher energy level. So here, for our understanding, just we are discussing with only one photon. Normally, when you pass light, millions of photons will be there. So that photons are absorbed by the atoms in the lower energy state, and it will move towards a higher energy state. So after reaching the higher energy level, so here lower energy state is given by E1, and higher energy state is E2. So this is the lower energy state and this is higher energy state. Okay. Now what happened means, so in general, what will happen? Lot of photons will occupy the higher energy state, that is in the E2 state. Now what happened means, among these atoms, some atoms has less lifetime and some other has high lifetime. Lifetime means in 10 power minus only. Anyway, some of the atoms have lower lifetime, so that atoms which has lower lifetime, it will come down quickly by emitting the photon which is absorbed already, and that is called as spontaneous emission. Okay, so automatically it comes down and emitting a photon. And the third case, apart from these photons, some of the photons are present in the higher energy level. They have high lifetime. So here, low lifetime, and here the atoms have high lifetime. And we can say this state as metastable state. Metastable state means the energy state where the atoms having higher lifetime. Okay, so here the stimulated emission, these atoms are stimulated by the external photons. Okay, so which is emitted by during the spontaneous emission, these photons stimulate this atom in the higher energy state. Now it comes down by emitting two photons. Okay, so how it will emit two photons? Already it absorbed one photon in this process, and we are stimulating this. Okay, so two photons by absorbing this, then it comes down by emitting these two photons. These two photon, then it will stimulate another two photons. It will emit four photons. Okay, two becomes four, and 4, 8, 16, it will goes on like a chain process, and finally you will get a high intensity beam. So this is how you will get a laser beam. So this is the basic processes. So here you see absorption or stimulated absorption, spontaneous emission, stimulated emission. So these are the three processes. Is population inversion, so this population inversion is nothing but the number of atoms in the higher energy state must be greater than the number of atoms in the lower energy state. So that is called as population inversion. We can say it as, here energy level is E2. So the number of atoms in the higher energy state, it is given by N2, and here it is N1. So N2 and N1. So for this condition, population inversion, N2 must be greater than N1. Okay, so this is again the same diagram. Explanation in detail. So this is population version, what I have said now. N2 must be greater than N1. Then only the stimulated emission will take place. So the condition is N2 greater than N1. So this is another one, 2 mark question, important 2 mark question. Population inversion. Okay, so higher energy state, number of atoms in the higher energy state is greater than the number of atoms in the lower energy state. N2 must be greater than N1. So here next one is the condition for population inversion. What are the conditions for population inversion? So there must be energy difference between the two energy levels, that is E2 minus E1, that is equal to hν. Then there must be a source to supply energy to the medium. You have to supply energy to the medium, then only the absorption takes place and followed by the spontaneous emission and the stimulated emission. And the atoms must be continuously raised to excited state. Okay, so if you provide this energy supply continuously, there will be the continuous rise of atoms towards the excited state. So these two are very important questions, population inversion and condition for population inversion. So first one is the characteristics of laser, then population inversion, conditions for population inversion. And one more is, what are the processes involved in the lasing action? So there is the stimulated absorption, spontaneous emission, then stimulated emission. Spontaneous means automatically happening. Okay, stimulated means because of some external stimuli. Okay, so let us discuss about this metastable state. So what is the metastable state? So as I said, normally the atoms having very less lifetime. Here you see 10 power minus 8 second. So 10 power minus 8 means not 1 second. What to say? 1 by 10 follow, 1 followed by 8 zeros. Okay, 1 by this value, 1 into 10 power 8. Of that, 1 part. Okay, so within that time, it will comes down. Okay, so the atoms having very small lifetime, so that is having 10 power minus 8 second. So these atoms will undergo spontaneous emission. Suddenly it comes down and it emits the photons and comes down. And some other atoms having long lifetime, that is 10 power minus 3 seconds, or even higher, maybe 10 power minus 2. So these atoms having higher lifetime, and they are called as the energy states which having such long lifetime are called as metastable states. Okay, right. So as we have discussed, there is excitement of atom or molecule. So there are different transitions are there: atomic transition, molecular transition, electronic transition. Different transitions are there. So here, normally atomic transition and molecular transition. So in carbon dioxide laser, we have molecular transition. Then in the case of helium ion, you have atomic transition, right? So this is about metastable state. So this one, so just note down these seconds. The atoms having short lifetime, that is in the order of 10 power minus 8 seconds. So long lifetime is in the order of 10 power minus 3 seconds. And the energy states corresponding to this is called as metastable states. Okay. Now, active medium. What is the active medium? So the medium in which the active, the population inversion takes place, that is called as active medium. I think you have, you are all familiar with this ruby laser. So in the ruby laser, ruby rod, you have ruby rod. There is a, it is made up of aluminium oxide, Al2O3, which is doped with chromium. Okay, so Al3 plus, it is replaced by chromium Cr3 plus in some places. Okay, so as a whole, it is in the form of a rod. So Al2O3, that is doped with chromium. That is called as ruby rod, and that ruby rod is the active medium for that ruby laser. Okay. For different laser, we have separate active medium, and the active material, active medium or active material, both are similar. Then pumping action. What is the pumping action? So we want to make the atoms or molecules to move towards the excited state. For that, we have to supply some energy, and that is called as pumping. Okay, so it is a process to achieve population inversion by using some external stimuli. Some external source of energy, and that is called as pumping action. Okay, so there are different types of pumping method are there. Okay, let us see one by one. So first one is optical pumping. So from the name itself, you can say it is optical, means it is deals with the light. So we can provide some energy in the form of light. So that's what we have discussed discussing the fundamentals. So here we have to provide the light energy. So in the case of ruby laser or NBR laser, we use the xenon flash lamp or krypton flash lamp. Okay, so these flash lamps are used for the excitation of atoms. So that is called as optical pumping. The next one is direct conversion. Direct conversion means this is nothing but it will happen in a diode laser. Here, when you forward bias that diode laser, there is space to drop. Okay. So we have PN junction diode. Not a normal PN junction diode, it is specially made. They have some direct band gap semiconductor. Normally, the gallium arsenide, this kind of materials are used. You know that P region is there, N region is there, and in between you have a potential barrier. At first, the electrons and the holes will cross over this, and finally we will have a potential barrier that is generated at the center. Okay, so here what happened means when you forward bias this, forward biasing means positive to positive and negative to negative. What happened? Positive positive repel each other, and negative negative also repel each other. Okay, so this tends to move this positive and negative, that means holes and electrons to collide at the center, that is in the potential barrier. Now what happens means, because of this recombination of these electrons and holes, will produce the photons. And this is called as direct conversion. So this is gallium arsenide laser. There are different examples are there. Okay, so it is a diode laser. So direct conversion that is happened in diode laser. So in our lab we have this diode laser. First one is optical pumping, second one is direct conversion, and then electric discharge method. So electric discharge method, for this we have to provide some power supply. So by providing the high potential, we can accelerate the electron. The normal electron, it can be accelerated to high velocity, and the highly accelerated electron, it collide with an atom at first. Okay, is collided with an atom, and it gives this energy. So E star means highly accelerated electron. It has a higher energy, so it gives this energy to this atom. And now this atom has more energy, and this electron becomes normal. Okay, so here it is mentioned everything. Normally it is happened in the gas laser, like helium neon laser and carbon dioxide laser. I think you have studied helium neon in your plus two. I think helium neon or carbon dioxide laser. Which one you have studied in your plus two? Helium neon or carbon dioxide laser? Students, Leo, which laser you have studied in plus two?
Sir, forgot.
Sir, laser pathi edhu varala.
Is it?
Yes, sir.
ஆமா சார், படித்த மாதிரி இல்ல.
ஓகே, ரைட். The previous year students, they said that they have studied this Ruby laser and helium neon laser, etc.
Okay, sir, right. So here lighting topic varala, sir.
But your syllabus has changed, no? Last year or the year before last year? Okay, right. So okay, listen. Now this atom is excited. That means it gets more energy and it moves towards the excited state, which means it is more energetic now, right? This is called as electric discharge method. And inelastic atom-atom collision. Right. So here we can say that helium neon laser. First, this helium, what happened to this means, first this helium collide with this highly accelerated electron, and now this helium move towards higher energy state. That means it will get more energetic, and the electron becomes normal. Now helium collide with, that means the helium with more energy that collide with neon, and neon move towards higher energy state, and helium loses its energy and becomes normal. And this process, this is called as inelastic atom-atom collision. It transfers its energy. Okay. So this is conserved. You know the law of conservation of energy. It transfers its energy, but not lost. Right. Okay. So here, this is the inelastic atom-atom collision. So just followed by the electric discharge process, this will happen. That is the inelastic atom-atom collision. Right. I think one more is there. Chemical reaction. One more process. chemical reaction or electrochemical reaction. So this is happened, the excitation takes place due to the chemical reaction. So normally it will happen in the dye laser. Okay, I'll give you some detail in the notes. So here you can see first optical pumping. This will happen in the solid state lasers like ruby laser and NDR laser. And second one is direct conversion. This will happen in the five minutes. Okay, so direct conversion, it is happen in diode laser. So just remember, here this is a solid state laser. It will happen the solid state laser. Here it will happen the diode laser. Diode laser, or you can say it is semiconductor laser. It is again classified into two: homo junction semiconductor laser and hetero junction semiconductor laser. And here this electric discharge and inelastic atom-atom collision. This will happen in gas laser like helium neon laser and carbon dioxide laser. So this example you should know. So here it is mentioned, it is used in the helium neon laser. Right. Only two more types are there. One is first we have studied about the different types of pumping method, and again we want to, if you want to improve the intensity of this laser, you should have an arrangement of resonant cavity. So this is the arrangement of resonant cavity. You have to place all this material inside this resonant cavity. We have two mirrors. The other arrangements will place inside this. If we have a ruby laser, this ruby rod, the xenon plasma, everything will be placed inside. And at the end, we have a 100% reflecting mirror, and you have a partially reflecting mirror. The photons that is produced by the stimulated emission that will reflect it back and forth, and by this reflection, its intensity will again increased further, and finally you will get the laser output here. Okay, so this is what called as resonant cavity. Very simple. You have a you have two mirrors. One is 100% reflecting, another one is partially reflecting, and they are traveling back and forth between these two reflecting surfaces, and it will grow in strength, and finally you will get a high intensity laser beam.